Invasive plants are one of the biggest threats to biological diversity because they come in, they take over, they push out that plant diversity, which is really the foundation for the rest of the web of life.
Some of the worst invaders at Elings Park are the same as the invaders we have in the wild spaces around Santa Barbara.
The main open space at Elings Park is the top of the mesa, and that's been heavily disturbed in the past by tilling and farming. And what came in after that was just a ton of different weeds, especially things like fennel, things like European mustard, things like invasive annual grasses from the Mediterranean region.
I'm really happy that we'll be working to restore, beautify, and improve that area. I think it's going to be a really good thing for both the plants, people, and animals that enjoy Elings Park.
My hope is that people will be inspired and excited by the power of native plants and the possibilities for them to really tackle the big challenges to biological diversity.
So invasive plants are species of plants that are not originally from a certain area and that are also causing a very negative impact.
Not all invasive plants are equal. Some are more ecosystem engineers where they change the fire frequency. They might create more soil erosion. They might change the nutrients in the soil. And they can change the whole system that makes it unsurvivable, uninhabitable for natives that have been there for eons.
So an invasive plant is not just a weed. A weed is any plant that you don't want. And there could be native weeds. If you didn't want it in your space, that's a weed. An invasive plant is a non-native plant that really takes over and changes the game in an ecosystem.
An invasive plant reduces biodiversity. It outcompetes the native plant, so it creates what we might call a monoculture. Whereas if you have an area with native vegetation, you might see 5, 10, 20 plants in that plant community. When it gets invaded by an invasive plant, that might reduce to 2 or 3 species. Largely, it's going to be the invasive plant, and there might be a couple other native plants that are able to survive alongside the invasive plant. So that has impacts on the web of life. That reduces the number of caterpillars that are going to be able to survive in that community, the number of bees that it supports.
Invaders have a leg up because they come without their natural enemies. So if you think about the benefits of natives is that they've evolved in a place with all of these creatures and everything kind of works together and keeps each other in check. These invaders come without these things that they've evolved with that eat them.
We've all seen eucalyptus trees that fall and the log stays there for years and years and years because there's not the bacteria that evolved with that tree, the insects that evolved with that tree to help break it down.
Probably the most impactful way that we feel invasive plants in California is through changes in our fire cycle. Many of our native habitats are adapted to some frequency of fire, but what happens when you have something like invasive annual grasses, for example, invade an area, is that all of a sudden you've created a ton of tinder in that ecosystem.
Our native grasses that used to cover these hillsides will be brown in a month. And we're used to seeing that, brown hills of California. The grasses that used to be up there before first contact were perennial grasses with a massive root system that were pulling up moisture from way deep, 30, 40 feet deep, 30 feet wide. The non-native grasses are capturing that same water. They're not going deep for the moisture, but they're taking any of the surface moisture, the rainfall, before it has a chance to maybe percolate into the groundwater. And they're using that for their growth. And then they grow faster because they only got 3 months maybe of their lifespan before they set seeds and die, turn into flammable materials covering the hillsides that we're all familiar with.
It lights very easily. And it also creates connectivity between things that might naturally be more spaced out. You might notice that a lot of our ecosystems here are shrub dominated. And in between those shrubs are gaps. So in the past, if you had, say, a lightning strike that started a fire, that fire might peter out relatively quickly because there isn't a bunch of fine fuel connecting all those shrubs. When grass comes in, it fills all those gaps and it basically creates just a whole connected corridor for fire to move. And once a system starts burning too much, that creates a positive feedback loop for those grasses. And before you know it, instead of having a shrubland, you have a grassland. And now you've just lost a lot of biodiversity and a lot of ecosystem function.
And there's a whole suite of those grasses, but really they're the poster child for an impact that's long past doing anything about. So you look at the hills in the spring when they green up, that's invasive annual grasses, and it's not what it used to be.
Many of the most invasive and the most well-established invasive plants have been here for about 300 years. They're plants that arrived with European settlers, European colonists.
Here in California, we see a lot of invasive plants that we have sort of arriving when the Spanish did, and the missionaries were moving around, and they had livestock, and they had plants, and they were moving up and down California, establishing their missions.
Some of these plants were deliberately brought over. Others were perhaps stuck in somebody's sock or their clothes or on the hide of livestock that were brought over. And in the process of altering California land use, these invasive plants have been able to take over.
The yellow mustard was introduced by the missionaries. It was a species that was familiar to them, and it looked pretty, bright yellow hills. They wanted something familiar that they could use, and they knew how to eat it. But now it's very, very abundant here and tends to choke out a lot of the species that we have native to this area.
You know, one of the ways we can think about the impact of invasive plants and culture is also acknowledging the fact that indigenous cultures had a system of land management that encouraged the native plants. We talked a little bit about feedback loops, and this is one of the feedback loops. When we remove that indigenous cultural practice, for instance, of burning or of coppicing or of tilling, we are removing the functions that encourage the native plants. And so that creates a feedback where those non-native plants can become invasive because the land use practice has been altered as well.
In the case of some of the invaders we have in California, like black mustard or the invasive annual grasses, we'll never have a landscape where those don't exist at all. But what we can do is fight them on the smaller scale, where we can take a place like Elings Park that's relatively contained, and we can put in a really big effort right there and knock them back enough to give natives a chance to reclaim their territory.
Here, like at Elings Park and elsewhere throughout the state where non-native invasives have been introduced, really the solution is outcompeting them, finding which species can outcompete those weeds. And so this project is not only looking at what can be drought tolerant, what can survive a new climate, but what can compete with invasive plants.
For Elings Park, what we want to do is have a healthy, strong population of native plant species. And if we have a couple of non-native species in there, that's fine. But what we're really looking for is the benefits that come with our native plants.
The question isn't necessarily how do we turn back the clock and restore an entire ecosystem, but how do we prioritize certain species or certain ecosystem functions that we can still live with some of the invasive plants, but we can maybe fight them back enough or change their ecology enough to incorporate the native biodiversity and bring back some of that functionality. We want that beautiful pampas grass in our yard, but those seeds get borne on the wind and they get taken to the steep cliff sides of our, you know, California coast, where they take hold and they alter the ecology and they change, you know, patterns of erosion and how the place looks.
Sometimes commercial nurseries sell species that are invasive or on the verge of being invasive, and people don't know that. So it's a good idea to do research in the types of plants that you're bringing into your garden, because they're not going to advertise that this plant is actually going to take over your entire garden and the hillside next to it.
There are a lot of great resources for people to figure out what is safe to plant in their area. If you come to a place like the garden, we're happy to help people figure out what's a good plant for their space.
There's actually a great website called Calscape, and you can get ideas for which plants that you want and where you can find them.
The Santa Barbara Botanic Garden can absolutely be a resource for figuring out what types of plants are well suited to your yard, whether that's native plants that we want to promote or non-native plants that we just want to make sure they're not causing more harm.
You can help a lot by planting a native, then you know you're not planting an invasive, and you're helping create more diverse habitat that supports life.